JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for March the 27th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, and what are today's important events and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, what happened yesterday? The US dollar continued to slide, equities continued to gain, even after the US initial jobless claims hit a record high. With regards to the coronavirus saga, new cases and new deaths continued to hit new records. And we also had Bank of England policy decision, with the bank standing pat, but as it was expected, the event was proven to be a non-event. Now, as for today's events, we get the US personal income and spending data for February, alongside the US core PCE year-over-year rate for the month. Now, as always, let's start with the performance of the greenback. The dollar continued sliding against the other G10 currencies on Thursday and during the Asian morning Friday. It lost the most ground versus the pound, the krone, and the Aussie in that order, while it lost the least ground against the euro, the Swiss franc, and the Canadian dollar. Now, the fact that the dollar kept weakening suggests that investors may have continued increasing their risk exposure for a third straight day. Indeed, major EU and US indices were a sea of green, with the positive investor morale rolling into the Asian session today. Both Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai Composite gained 3.88% and 0.26% respectively. Now, yesterday, the main event on the agenda were the initial jobless claims for last week. The forecast was for a surge to 1 million new people signing for unemployment benefits due to companies announcing layoffs and state lockdowns forcing stores to close. However, the actual number was much higher, hitting a record of 3.283 million. Strangely, at least to us, equities continued to surge, with the S&P 500 completing an around 15% recovery since Monday and Dow Jones exiting bearish market territories after completing a 21% recovery this week. This may have been due to the fact that claims were still below the upper end of the forecast's range, which was at 4 million. Or it could be due to increasing expectations that further stimulus may be in the works. After all, the bad print came after the Senate approved a $2 trillion US dollars fiscal stimulus package, which is widely anticipated to pass through the House of Representatives later today, and after Fed Chair Powell said in a televised interview that the Fed is not going to run out of ammunition and that they still have policy room for more action. Now, with the committee already cutting rates to the 0.025% range and announcing unlimited amounts of QE purchases, this raises a question: will the Fed go for negative rates? The Fed has never been in favor of the negative rates regime, but it remains to be seen whether the economic damage caused by the coronavirus will force them to make an exception. Now, at least according to the yields of the Fed Fund futures, the investors do not expect something like this at the moment. As for our view, despite the latest rally in risk appetite, it has not changed. Even if equities continue to gain for a while more, we find it difficult to trust a long-lasting recovery. New infected cases and deaths hit another record yesterday, as you can see from this graph here, which suggests that the virus continues to spread at an exponential pace and that we have not reached a peak yet. Thus, the economic damages could deepen and the wounds could drag much more than investors currently anticipate. Thus, we would treat the current treat the recent risk on rally or any extensions of it as a strong corrective bounce at the moment. We still see decent chances for risk-linked assets to turn south again at some point and for the greenback to wear its safe haven suit and start shining again, although it may also continue correcting for a while more. We repeat that in order to change our view, a vaccine has to be ready for distribution, and certainly the vaccine in this case is not fiscal spending, neither monetary policy easing. Now, apart from the jobless claims, which took center stage yesterday, we also had a Bank of England gathering, but as it was expected, it was proven a non-event. Under the leadership of the new governor, Andrew Bailey, policymakers decided to keep interest rates unchanged at 0.1% and also agreed unanimously to continue with the program of £200 billion of UK government bond and sterling non-financial investment grade corporate bond purchases to take the total stock of their purchases to £645 billion. With regards to officials' future plans, they noted that they will continue to monitor the situation closely and that they stand ready to respond further if needed. Now, as for today's events, we get the US personal income and spending data for February alongside the core PCE year-over-year rate for the month. Personal income is forecast to have slowed to 0.4% month-over-month from 0.6%, something supported by the slide of the average hourly earnings month-over-month rate for the same month, while personal spending is anticipated to have grown 0.2% month-over-month, the same pace as in January. That said, bearing in mind that retail sales for the month slid 0.5% month over month, we see the risks surrounding the spending forecast as tilted to the downside. With regards to the core PCE year-over-year rate, which is the Fed's favorite inflation metric, it is expected to have ticked up to 1.7% year-over-year from 1.6%. Having said all that, though, we don't expect this data to alter expectations around monetary policy. The Fed and other major central banks have been in a coordinated rescue mission, easing massively their respective policies in order to prevent the global economy from falling into recession, or at least to recover as quickly as possible in case it does. Thus, economic data may have been put aside for now, with investors not paying the attention they would have under normal circumstances. So, that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So, goodbye from me, have a great weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week.
JFT, just fair and direct.